What's going on, guys? It's your boy Matt St. Jack. Whether you're an avid anime fan, a wee tadpole still finding your way, or anywhere in between, I'll be providing my opinions and insights on anime old and new. Think Yelp with help from friends and producers from other shows weighing in. I know you can't wait to hear, and I can't wait to tell, so let's get to it. This is Matt St. Jack with Anime Talk. Let's go.
I'm Bo Maddox.
I'm Robert Ortegon.
And I'm Ashley Chancellor.
And this is Collateral Cinema and the Raiders of the Lost Ark. Welcome to Collateral Cinema, the only movie podcast that matters, where we focus on good movies, bad movies, and everything else in between in the world of cinema. We are podcasting straight from somewhere in South Texas, and yes, my friends, we are a 420-friendly podcast, so whatever you have, smoke it if you've got it.
That is exactly what is going on right now, right, everybody?
Oh, hell yeah.
Hell yeah, man.
Oh, I'm here. I didn't miss it. Anything, right?
No, yeah,
I'm not missing you nothing, right, either.
No, of course you're not, dude. I mean, shit. So,
I usually call in sick or...
You're like, I can't, I won't.
My flight's delayed.
I got to call my agent.
From New York to California, just because hectic, you know?
Really. My God, Robert. I mean, you're just going between New York and LA and SA. It's a busy life, right? It's the rut, really, right?
I mean, I'm a Texan. I have to come back to my hometown. So.
I mean, yeah, you're not wrong, right?
So, you know, I got to love the whole Texas thing and what the industry is trying to do with Texas, and I hope they choose me and us.
Oh, yes.
Us.
Yeah. No, we need to become the poster children of Texas cinema.
Definitely.
Honestly, yeah. I mean, it wouldn't hurt. I mean...
Well, tonight, we're actually, once again, we're together under one roof, which is nice. And we're talking about the latter two films of the Indiana Jones trilogy. So this is part two of our Indiana Jones trilogy episode. We will be covering Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom and Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. One of these is my least favorite Indiana Jones movie out of the trilogy. And the other one is my favorite Indiana Jones movie out of the trilogy. But I'll tell you what, they're both great fucking movies.
Oh, man. These two movies are quite possibly two of the most consequential sequels of all time when you really get down to it. Because, I mean, first of all, you have Temple of Doom, which is just this real kind of a little bit of a... one-off in a way, you know? I mean,
it's very different.
Yeah. I mean, compared to Raiders and Last Crusade, you know? And I mean, it actually continues the tight storytelling, the tight editing, and the amazing action sequences that the first movie is known for.
Honestly, yeah, it leaves right off from the very first one. But then, yeah, The Last Crusade is the prequel to Raiders of the Lost Ark.
No, it's the other way around. Temple of Doom.
Temple of Doom?
Yeah.
Well, Temple of Doom is set before Raiders, which Temple is interesting.
I'm sorry, yeah.
Yeah, but your point still stands,
right,
Robert.
Yeah.
It really does, you know. I mean, actually, kind of taking the prequel angle.
I worded that wrong. I'm sorry.
No, it's all good, man. You're good.
Yeah, and I actually, it's kind of interesting that this movie is a prequel. And there are a couple of reasons that are speculated. I think Spielberg gave out one reason. George Lucas gave out another. But essentially, it's one thing is that they didn't want to do the Nazis again was one take I've heard on why it's a prequel to Raiders. The other take is that it explains why Marion isn't there and so why she was replaced by Kate Capshaw. Why on God's earth did we replace Karen Allen with Kate Capshaw? I don't know, but...
Oh, man. I mean, I guess for what it is, Kate Capshaw's performance is fine, maybe, you know? I mean, I kind of feel like she's really trying to channel, like, really, like, old golden age actresses of her time, right?
Oh, right, yeah. Robert? I try to capture the golden age era too.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, she kind of has that. What's a good like Rita Hayworth or something like that, or you know, maybe a Jane Mansfield.
That's
or
funny
something
that
like
you mentioned that, man. I'm trying to bring that back. You know.
Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, I know what you mean. I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah, yeah. It's one of those things that I mean. It's what I kind of like a lot of the new batch of actors and actresses now is that they're kind of starting to have a little bit of that old school feel to them, you know, like modern, yeah. But kind of classic.
Yeah. That's what you get with me. Actually.
I mean, for fuck's sake, look at Jenna Ortega. I mean,
enough.
Yeah. She's a very striking actress. So,
but yeah, for better or worse, the lead actress role has been changed to Kate Capshaw, who would then go on to marry George Lucas, I believe, or Steven Spielberg.
Yeah, it was Spielberg.
It was Spielberg.
But the interesting thing about that is, I mean, I remember a Family Guy episode that was talking about basically how she got that role because she was fucking the director, essentially. I mean, I think that's a little reductive because Kate Capshaw has talent. She can act, but I'm just not really sure what she was going for here.
I don't know if it's that she was written as an unlikable character or if it's the performance or a combination of both, but yeah. She's not my favorite part of this movie. That being said, I think her opening scene is actually pretty effective. The whole dance number.
Her opening scene is actually the most riveting part of the movie for me. It kind of goes outside of the movie a little bit, right?
It does. It's such a weird way to start an Indiana Jones movie. On the surface, but it honestly kind of like, because I grew up watching all of these movies together, so for me that is kind of part of the Indiana Jones mythos, so to speak. It's just kind of this brand, and but like when you look at it in retrospect, it's so different from Raiders and Last Crusade, which comes after. But I mean, it's almost as iconic as the Raiders opening scene, you know, as far as I'm concerned.
It really is. And it really evokes old Hollywood in so many ways. I mean, especially, you know, evoking that era of musical cinema, you know, I mean, that used to be the norm, you know, like I've been seeing a lot of stuff on social media that, I mean, a lot of like younger audiences, like, they won't actually show up to a movie if it's billed as a musical. Like the recent Wonka movie is kind of like that, you know? They didn't actually promote it as a musical, even though inostensibly it is. You know? I mean, it has musicals.
Fair enough.
You know? But, I mean, here in this movie, it kind of evokes that... that moment that also I kind of feel like Barbie, like Greta Gerwig kind of brought that back a little bit, you know, like the whole, the whole I'm Knuff song. I kind of feel like that whole sequence that actually kind of feels a lot like this sequence here in Temple of Doom.
Yeah, so like the I'm Just Ken dance number compared to, yes, I can see it. Yeah. And it's interesting because it starts out as an in-universe show that they're watching in Shanghai at Club Obi-Wan.
Yeah.
Which is a neat Club little Easter egg.
Holy shit.
And Andy is sitting down with a deal with these Chinese mobsters, I guess.
Yeah.
Lao Che and his goons.
And that's kind of an old trope in old Hollywood movies that I guess Spielberg was kind of lampshading there a little bit about, you know, the quote unquote Orientalism a little bit. So, something that's a little, you know, definitely not politically correct or woke or whatever you want to call it these days. But yeah, back then that was a common trope, you know, and that's actually kind of brought back later on in Temple of Doom whenever we go to the what palace was it called? Is
Pankot Palace.
Yeah, at Pankot Palace, I mean, you have that feast that they have, which we have to talk about this. This feast is probably one of the things that probably moved me towards veganism.
Is it vegan, Bo?
No, none of that is vegan. I understand.
Surprise.
Here's what I'm gonna say about that. I understand the criticisms that a lot of more leftist vegans will put when it comes to how vegans approach omnivores and carnists in other cultures. I mean, of course, my answer to that is, you know, that's incumbent upon the people within that culture who are vegan to change that culture. It's not my place. It's not the place of other vegans to decide. It's the place of vegans within that particular culture.
Exactly. Stuff
for like within Indian culture, I mean, in spite of what this movie shows, there's a lot of dishes in Indian cuisine that are definitely vegan or at least vegetarian friendly.
A few of the places that we've gone together, Bo, has been Indian joints because there are a lot of vegetarian and vegan options there. And the thing is, as funny as too, is like Indian cuisine is fucking amazing. Like I love some like chicken tikka masala and shit, man.
For me, it's like chana masala, aloo gobi. I mean, samosas are typically vegan. I mean, also, what's another good one? Usually they have the mixed vegetables as well. Those are good.
But if you really want to dig into Indian cuisine, try some snick. Surprise.
See, that's what makes me cringe. It's like, I mean, hell, you want to talk about, you know, I mean, taking an insensitive view on other cultures. Yeah. It's like, I mean, this is like Orientalism just kind of kicked up to the nth degree here.
This is one of my problems with Temple of Doom and why I think it's the weakest of the trilogy. Still a great film, and we'll get to that, but the stereotypical view of cultures here, of India... Yeah, it's just not it, Chief. It's a little off. That being said, that feast scene is iconic. I mean, just like the snakes, little snakes coming out of the big snake, the chilled monkey brain and shit. Short Round and Willie are just like completely disgusted. And in the background, you know, we're kind of getting this like exposition on what's going on with the film.
I feel what you're saying there. It's something that's definitely unacceptable in this day and age. And, you know, to me, like I said, it's a little ironic as a vegan, given the criticisms that we receive, you know, and here's this example of, you know, basically the same thing that we're accused of, but it's like taken to a carnist degree, you know? So,
yeah. Yeah, totally. I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
But like, yeah, if you're going to deliver exposition, doing it like this, I think is one of the more entertaining ways of doing it. And that's really just what the trilogy as a whole does well. And also just how well paced each movie is. And honestly, I would say that Temple of Doom is the fastest paced movie out of the bunch. And that's a good thing.
Well, I remember when we were watching the Chris Stuckman review, which is kind of like another one of those mandatory review shows that we watch when we want to kind of get at least a basic sense of what a basic, you know, film critic would be talking about. You know,
your average film critic. All his reviews on this trilogy. I watched the Nostalgia Critic review on Temple of Doom. I mean, that's just kind of like, before we get into it, we're going to listen to some of those, but...
Yeah. But, you know, it's like one of the things that he brought up is that it almost feels like there isn't even a second act here. sort of. It goes kind of goes from first act to third act in a way.
You know, I would argue the second act is marked by when they come underground and like they witness the thuggy cult ritual.
Yeah.
And then the third act is kind of like when Indy wakes up and they do kind of like the prison break sequence. But even saying that, it's almost like there isn't a second act because that second act is really short when you think about it.
It's very short. I mean, I would say that the second act really begins whenever they actually crash in India. Arguably.
You think so? Okay.
Yeah, I would say that that's where it kind of starts, you know, is that whole crash and the raft scene and everything. And then they meet the elder of the village or whatever.
The
village elder. The guru, yeah. the village guru or elder or whatever. The village. And I would say that that's where the second act begins. And when you take it from there to when... to that first thuggy ritual, it's like, yeah, that's a very, very small amount of time within the movie.
It really is. And during this time, you're getting to know these characters. I mean, this movie, any of the Indiana Jones movies is a standalone movie. Like, so it works as an introduction to the character. You could watch it without having seen Raiders and it's fine. So, you know, you get a feel for who Indy is. He's kind of a scoundrel here. And then you get a feel for Willie. She's annoying. She's a diva. And then you get Short Round. And it's actually a crime that he hasn't been brought up already because Kyehoe Kwan's performance, or I guess his dynamic with Harrison Ford, I think is my favorite part of this movie. He just really is the shining star. And I know, like, back in the day, I think he was kind of like the Jar Jar Binks of this movie.
Oh, very much so. He was, and which was so fucking unfair.
But, like, honestly, like, he's brilliant. I fucking love... I mean, this is the same kid that played Data in The Goonies. And recently, I loved his role as Ouroboros in Loki Season 2. He was in Everything Everywhere All at Once. I mean, he's just brilliant.
And he won an Academy Award, of course, which was so deserving.
Didn't he hug Harrison Ford on stage or something?
Not just that, but even beforehand, he actually reconnected with
Harrison Ford. Brother.
Yes, exactly. But he basically walked up to Harrison Ford, and then he looked at him. He was just like, "You're Short Round."
Yeah,
like straight up, just like, "You're Short. Come here."
Didn't remember him. Almost.
So fucking wholesome.
Oh, it's
man.
The heart of the Ugh. Movie because Willie doesn't wake him up
at
from his stupor. Short Round does.
At the same time, Brendan Fraser was there, getting the.
Which movie are you talking about?
The Academy Award, right?
Yeah. Brendan Fraser won his Academy Award.
His Encino brother. They were both in Encino Man, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's true. They were. Yeah. That's actually hilarious.
That is very nostalgic. Yeah.
That is actually really awesome.
Totally dope.
Sean Astin was there too.
Yeah. Jamie Lee Curtis winning the Academy Award as well.
For Halloween Ends. Oh, sorry. What?
no, it was for Everything Everywhere All at Once.
It wasn't Halloween Ends, right? Okay.
Michelle Yeoh. That was actually a good Oscar telecast. I don't think I'm going to watch this year. I don't know why. I don't really care that much about the Oscars, but...
Yeah.
I mean...
I've never really watched them.
You know, you got to space out the Oscars.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, not everybody can be.
I mean, it seems like just yesterday, Joaquin Phoenix won for Joker. So it's like, you know.
You got to space out that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But between all the actors, there's so many actors in Hollywood, right?
You're not wrong, dude.
You know, I mean, got to let them all shine somehow.
Right. But anyway, I feel that the dynamic between... Harrison Ford's Indy and Kyehoe Kwan's Short Round is really like the heart of this film. I mean, I think it's no accident that it's Short Round that wakes Indy up from his stupor, not Willie, right?
No, absolutely. He
One
is,
Eye Willie? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, no, I would argue that in many ways, Short Round is absolutely the heart of this movie.
He is, man. I mean, he is kind of like the the center of attention Indy City's in, he's the impetus in many situations. And I mean, yeah, just like the whole story kind of, I think, revolves around, you know what I mean? I think his relationship with Indy just really just kind of like a central focus here. And yeah, I love the fuck out of him. I'm like, how could you not love Short Round? He's so great.
It's like, you kind of just have to look at it through the lens of the time it came out. You know, I mean, people were just those types of characters in movies were becoming a dime a dozen. You know,
he's the one that broke his chains and fucking started, you know, the fucking revolt.
Yeah. So
essentially, you saw all the slave children just kind of looking up at him and like, you know, and he's just being a badass, man. He knows martial arts, which is cool.
Yeah,
absolutely. It's like Everything Everywhere All at Once. He would he would use that to full effect.
Hey, Shorty, stop palling around with that kid.
Exactly. Yeah, the magistrate. That's a creepy little kid, right?
I don't think he knew it was going from that.
The magistrate.
The
magistrate. Oh. I think that's what that word might mean, is actually like magistrate, Maharaj. It might actually translate to magistrate.
Seen that with wrestling.
But I don't know if anybody who speaks Hindi correct us. Go ahead. But he's a creepy little kid, isn't he?
We see that with Jinder Mahal, the Maharaja.
Oh, Jinder Mahal.
The Maharaja.
The Maharaj.
Yeah.
Yes, we're not worthy of
WWE,
Jinder Mahal.
WWE, right?
Oh, yes, fuck yeah.
But yeah, he's a creepy little shit. Although he's just a pawn of Mola Ram, as it turns out. So I guess, you know, that's fitting. And you know, I don't know. He's the one that tells them to go out the left tunnel, even though they don't go out the left tunnel, but they end up okay.
Yeah, right. That's kind of weird.
I mean, I think the thing with Temple of Doom, again, like you said, Bo, is it, in tone, it's so different from what came before and everything, really. I mean, we're going from the Judeo-Christian theology to the Hindu one, for one. Also, the film is quite a bit more violent than the other two.
Absolutely. This is one of the darker movies in this trilogy, and also one of the movies that was the impetus for a PG-13 rating, along with, I believe it was also this Last Crusade, and I think finally a Poltergeist kind of broke. That broke the camel's back there. So
I mean, for fuck's sake, they're severed fingers.
But also, you know, Gremlins came out, and that was actually a really, really grody fucking movie that was actually gory in its own right.
Yeah.
You know, that also kind of led to the PG-13 rating a little bit. So
very early. Yeah.
Yeah.
And of course we have the thuggy ritual scene where the dude, and I mean, I watched these movies as a child, mind you. Like, you know, I was watching these on VHS.
This is also the era that film was going to go into the garbage.
The 80s?
Because television was very in. Television series. You know, like Starsky and Hutch.
I would argue that the 80s were a really consequential decade for movies, you know?
So I think the 80s, you know, coming out of like 1978, you know, coming out of the Halloween, like John Carpenter said, he didn't know what the fuck was going to happen, right?
Yeah.
So he made a movie called Halloween, right?
Exactly.
And then after that, everything followed, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Sleepaway Camp, Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah, yeah.
So he created a genre right when the movie industry was going to end.
True.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
And that's something. He turned that fucking shit around, right?
I mean, hell, the 80s was the time when, like, I mean, United Artists went under because of Heaven's Gate and whatnot, you know? So, yeah, no, that was a crazy time in filmmaking.
And it really was. And, yeah. I mean, to have a scene like the thuggy ritual scene, you know, where this dude fucking takes, you know, Mola Ram comes and he takes this dude's heart, rips it out of his chest and lowers him into lava. All the time they're shouting, you know, they're chanting, you know, and it's and the heart catches on fire as the dude catches on fire. I mean, I watched this shit as a kid.
Yeah, now this brings me back to what I said in the Raiders episode where we were talking about, you know, when we first encountered the movie, and I said, you know, like I got scared because I saw the ending scene on an Oscars telecast and everything. Well, this time around, I don't know, like that was actually kind of, it wasn't as gruesome, strangely enough, for me at this point, you know. And this is like literally the Kano fatality and whatnot, you know?
Seriously.
I mean, you can't tell me that this wasn't the inspiration for Kano's fatality all the way.
It probably was.
Kano fatality. Oh, shit.
Yeah, from
ripping the heart out of the chest, you know?
I was just saying, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that wouldn't surprise me at all. I mean, yeah, it was pretty grody, but man, like, I fucking ate this shit up. Fun fact, you know, I guess as a kid, Temple of Doom was actually my favorite, right? In retrospect, I rewatched these and it's no longer my favorite, but in fact, out of the trilogy, I feel like it's the weakest film. But as a kid, man, I don't know. I just, this shit was like, it just stuck in my mind. It was so iconic.
Well, the thing about Temple of Doom is that it's the one movie out of this trilogy that best exemplifies a standalone movie. You could watch this movie alone and be introduced to Indiana Jones, be introduced to the world he inhabits, be introduced to his character and everything that he does. Like this could have even been a good first movie before Raiders, even. If we really want to do the prequel thing.
If you want to do it in chronological order, it would actually work.
Texas Sundown? What?
Texas Sundown.
Texas Sundown.
Yes. Please watch Texas Sundown on YouTube.
Well, yeah. But Robert, I think that, you know, what's interesting is that you can look at the cinematic techniques, you know, like some of the shots that we even took in Texas Sundown, and you can kind of see, you know, where am I trying to go with this?
I took a lot of the landscaping just from being
I think even if you didn't watch Indiana Jones like we did as a kid, like you could have still been indirectly influenced by it.
I know.
Because you were influenced by movies that were influenced by it.
I was mostly influenced by shorts and old theater, really, too. Exactly. Yeah. Just like Indiana Jones.
Right, but you also watched old movies, you know, or maybe what ended up influencing Indiana Jones.
The reason I try to be an actor, or I am an actor, is because of the old acting, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
I want to bring that whole thing back, dude. It's lost. It's lost. I want to bring it back.
They don't fucking make movies like this anymore. Like, when I'm watching these movies and I'm looking at the pacing, the comedic timing, the dialogue, I'm just like, you know what I mean? People just don't make movies like this anymore. And if you try to, it's just going to end up coming out as derivative, really.
I mean, look for an example, the recent Uncharted movie that we did an episode on.
Yeah.
Ash.
I think
it's like to me, that's a movie that exemplifies, you know, and it's an Indiana Jones clone, but, you know, well, I mean, arguably Uncharted as a game series was basically basically an attempt at an Indiana Jones type of story.
It is, and we mentioned that in the last part.
But that movie falls flat for a lot of reasons, you know, and in least of which is some of the action set pieces felt a little bit done before, you know? It felt too referential, you know, when it comes to Indiana Jones to me.
That's the problem.
I was going to say, like, Legends of the Hidden Temple of Nickelodeon.
Oh, my God,
I'm
Robert.
I'm sorry, bro.
Legends. Dude, we could go into a whole nother tangent about Legends of the Hidden Temple. That is a legendary show that was a meat grinder to actually
I sent you a link
in.
Over the Hey Dude Ranch, right?
Yeah, oh, no, I saw the Hey Dude Ranch. Yeah, they found it.
If we went there, you'd be like, dude.
I remember Hey Dude.
Nostalgia tripping. Now find
me the camp that
would be your childhood. Right?
Where's the camp where Salute Your Shorts?
I was going to say that we need to go there.
That would be. Has that been found?
I have not seen that yet. If I found the link, I would send it to you. And I'm like, dude, we need to go.
No fucking.
Because it's probably in Texas, right?
It might be. No, more than likely that's in Texas or maybe Arizona or New Mexico.
Yeah, exactly, bro.
Yeah. Anyway, tangent over.
we're nerding out.
We're nerding out on stupid, on random
shit. We
got to
nerd out because it's just like we're lost in history.
But no, what's interesting, you know, you brought up a good point, Bo, is that like, what works with Indiana Jones is actually a lot of times pretty simple in nature. It just really hadn't been done before. The problem is that even if you try to pull that off now, it's just going to come off as being too referential. Just like you said, you know, it's like, yeah, we've seen it before. And so I think, like, what works best about a movie like Uncharted is that, yeah, it's like, it reminds you of Indiana Jones. And when it was a video game, that kind of works. And then it's just like, oh, well, it's another movie that's, well, feels derivative of Indiana Jones.
The interesting thing with Uncharted is, I mean, way back then, like right after Raiders came out, Canon Films released their version of an Indiana Jones movie, and that's Alan Quartermain in The Lost City of Gold.
Oh, yeah.
Which is streaming for free on Tubi, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. Definitely check that one out. It is total campy goodness, and it actually does kind of hit some of the same story beats as Raiders or something like that. You know, it kind of has that same feel to it, but it also has Richard Chamberlain and Sharon Stone and James Earl Jones.
Motherfucking Earl Jones.
Fuck yeah, man.
Earl Jones, bro.
And I would argue that movie kind of got Indiana Jones a little better than most of other clones, especially Uncharted all these years later, you know?
Yeah.
And that was back in the 80s.
But yeah, it's like so much of like what makes Indiana Jones good. And as I was watching all three of these films, it's like, that's actually considered pretty basic by today's standards. But at the time, you know, this was kind of revolutionary in a sense.
No, you're right. This movie is, the series is responsible for bringing lots of other movies into the darkness, out of the darkness.
It kind of pioneered the modern adventure genre.
But it also influenced gaming as well.
The gaming, the comic book genre.
Like, look at Tomb Raider.
That's where it's at, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Tomb Raider is fucking hardcore.
Oh, for sure. And like some of like the grody bits, I think, of Temple of Doom have really kind of influenced cinema and gaming as a whole. One thing that I Stuckman actually noted in his review was that Spielberg's attitude towards violence actually drastically changed after Temple of Doom.
Yeah, he got a little jumpy about using really hardcore violence. And even though, I mean, in Last Crusade, which we're going to talk about here in a little bit, you know, there were decapitations even and whatnot. There's a lot of really graphic violence in that movie. It just wasn't bloody violence, you know.
Yeah,
that was the difference.
There's kind of an exploitative feel to the first two Indiana Jones movie, and especially Temple.
Oh, Temple is absolutely
right.
Temple is an exploitative serial film. That's what that is.
You're going from one to the other.
Yeah,
which the other one being a prequel.
No, Temple is absolute exploitation, but Temple though is still to me a movie that is ultimately just the most fun out of the trilogy to watch. I feel
it really is the most fun, man. And I think what works about it too, again coming back to it, is it's very simple. Like, for instance, the villain in this movie, you know, like the antagonist Forrest, is our child slavers. And I think what connects with the audience and what resonates with us, and again, I mentioned in the last episode of way that we used to feel about Nazis, is that we're just so instantly repulsed by it. I mean, there's that scene where Indy, who up to this point, you know, considering this is the earliest film in his adventure career, you know, hasn't really developed the moral compass that we would see later. Although I would argue he's kind of always a scoundrel. That never really changes. But even he is absolutely just so abhorrent of this act that without thinking, I mean, you can see it in his face. And Harrison Ford is so good at just portraying Indy, and like you can just feel the emotion, because you know, you look at his face and like you want to hit that child slaver that's whipping the kid with a rock as well. You want to throw a rock at him, and then you look at his face where like the realization sets in what he just did. Nah, he did that without thinking. You know, any person would do that. And so already, you know, you're emotionally invested because you're like, yeah, fuck those fucking child slavers. That's fucking bullshit, man. And you know, it makes the third act all the more compelling.
A child slavery. I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, no, fuck child slavery. Absolutely.
I will hang them, or I will shoot them.
Well, hey, fun fact: child labor is back in various states. So, yeah.
But I guess we'll sort of wrap up our thoughts on Temple of Doom here so we can move on to
the next one.
I'm really excited. I have so much to say about this. Temple of Doom, guys. What are your final thoughts?
I feel like, the critical reappraisal that Temple has received lately is definitely worth it. I mean, it's what I would argue is closest to a horror film in the franchise a little bit, but kind of a horror in like the more universal sense, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I think that, Temple is great as a standalone movie, like I mentioned earlier. Like, you can absolutely just show this to somebody completely outside of the actual trilogy and everything, and it would still make sense. It would stand on its own, and it would be its own story, you know? And I think that that's what's the most admirable thing about this movie, you know?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. It's 100% a film that could just stand on its own and just represent Indiana Jones as a whole. Arguably any one of these movies could, but Temple of Doom has a certain quality to it that's just like, yeah, this is the archetypal Indiana Jones film, even though it's the odd one out. How does that work?
Yeah, they all feel like it's like the first one. Only that Raider of the Lost Ark, we know that's the very first one, right? But, yeah, like you said, they stand alone with a cliffhanger edge, man. Like, I would like to bring to every one of my fucking films, you know what I mean?
For sure.
Towards, you know, you grabbed your audience, and it's like, okay, now where do we run with this? You know what I mean? Like,
exactly. Yeah, like, where do we go from here? And honestly, you know, it pays off. And, you know, I could say that Last Crusade, the next film we're going to talk about here, also is a good standalone film. But there are parts of it that actually work better as an emotional payoff. Having watched movies, having experienced these adventures with these characters over the years. And I think that's maybe why it may be my favorite Indiana Jones film of all time. Wait, I'm getting ahead of myself though, okay? Temple of Doom, all right? Final thoughts. I think the only thing I can say about it is, Molaram, prepare to meet Kali in hell.
The old legend of the Shankara stones. The villager's sacred rock was taken.
Village stories, Dr. Jones.
Fortune and glory, kid. Fortune and glory.
I thought archaeologists were always funny little men searching for their mummies.
God, okay, so if there's any movie that's even more quotable than Raiders of the Lost Ark or Temple of Doom, it's The Last Crusade. God, man, this movie is my favorite out of the bunch because it has everything that Raiders has, which is being like a perfect movie in all sense. But it also has just this consistent humor throughout the movie. It's just consistently funny the entire time, and I vibe with it.
It is arguably the funniest movie of the franchise, really. But Harrison Ford's comedic timing is just so spot on in so many ways. I mean, he really knocks it out of the park.
He really does. I mean, even going back to there's a scene in Temple of Doom. I'm gonna flash back to it real quick because I forgot I did want to mention this, but where, you know, he's like, "Nice try, Lao Che." And then he shuts the plane door and it says Lao Che Airlines. Like, you know, it's just moments just like that. Or when he runs
Mr. Jones.
Yes. And then when he runs up on the thuggy cult, you know, and then suddenly realizes that that there's a lot more of them than him, and he runs back, you know.
He's outnumbered.
He's outnumbered entirely. And that comedic timing that we saw in that film, that we saw in Raiders, for instance, with the improvised sword fight gunshot scene, you know, like that, just like comedic timing is amplified by like a billion in Last Crusade. There's just the synergy between him and Sean Connery, who, if Kihoi Kwan and Harrison Ford were the best part of Temple of Doom, then Sean Connery and Harrison Ford are the best part of Last Crusade.
Junior. That's right. I'm Sean Connery.
Junior.
I'm now going to talk about this movie.
Oh,
this
God.
This movie is one of the greatest movies I've ever done.
It really is one of his best performances, and that's even comparing him, you know, with his Bond performance.
Compared me to my sword.
Compare me to my sword.
I suddenly remembered my Charlemagne. Let my armies be the rocks and the trees and the birds and the sky.
Hell yeah, man.
That's for blasphemy. That's entrapment, Ash. Catherine Zeta-Jones.
Are we just going to do this entire, the rest That's of this right. podcast with Sean entire, Connery
I'll
impressions?
I'll do all this in Sean Connery voice.
Sean Connery.
That's right. I am now going to do all this in Sean Connery voice. But this movie, The Last Crusade. Now, let me tell you about this movie.
Illumination.
It was very illuminating. It was illuminating so
let
much
Let me just
ways.
Say one thing.
Sean, are you really going to interrupt me?
I was gonna.
You motherfucker!
Sing.
That's for blasphemy.
That's for blasphemy. I do that to my women as well. Slap.
I'm sorry. I was gonna sing some S thing.
No, actually, you know that's actually legitimately Sean Connery defended hitting
Sam's
women.
Sam's quietly by.
Yeah, he
quietly by the seashore. How do you say that? With the S's.
She shall by the seashore. That's right.
You know what I'm talking about, right?
But that Nazi bitch that I slept with. I knew exactly that she was a Nazi because she talks in her sleep. She talks in her sleep, and I'll tell you right now, we must go and we must find the Holy Grail.
Oh, I was rather wonderful. In my dragon's heart.
My dragon's heart.
I have my dragon's heart.
Highlander. We're Highlanders.
We're Highlanders. This is my sword.
Yes. But yes. Yeah, it's just like his, like the dialogue between him and Harrison Ford. I swear some of these lines are just like ingrained in my childhood memories. Just this like banter between them throughout the film. It's like from the point that Sean Connery comes into Last Crusade, the film just has this consistent quality to it that just never misses a beat. Every joke lands. It's so good. I mean, just like even, you know, simple things like, you know, the Nazis are pointing guns at them and they're like, "Dr. Jones?" Yes, at the same time.
Yes.
You know, or when he first meets his dad, and, you know, he's like, it breaks the heart because he broke the 14th century Ming Dynasty vase, you know, and the head. And then, you know, like, he's like,
it's fake.
I'll never forgive myself.
And he thinks he's talking about him,
and he's like, "Oh, it's all right, Dad." And then he's like, Thank God.
It's fake.
You can look at the cross stitching. And I'm like, you know, it's just like, you just see their entire like dynamic.
Your hat tipped into Walking Phoenix into Harrison Ford.
Brilliant, brilliant cut.
It's a League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, which is where I retired.
Oh, yeah, no, let's talk about that opening scene, because... Oh,
that was a great scene.
Indy's father, Henry, does play into that scene as well. That's also where we get the first, you know...
Oh, man, River Phoenix, let me tell you, god damn.
Stand by me, bro.
Oh, man, rest in peace, bro. I mean, his performance in this intro here, I mean, it's interesting because we kind of get two intros in one movie.
We do. Here.
You know, we get the young Indiana Jones intro, which has a lot of interesting, red herrings, and kind of also shows where, Indy kind of gets his idea of what an adventurer is. You know, it's this this one thief that's trying to take it's the crucifix of Coronado, right? The cross of Coronado or something like that?
The cross of Coronado. Yeah, and what's interesting is there's even kind of a fake out where... We don't actually know what's going on. We're in Utah. We see these kids. What are they? Boy Scouts.
They're Boy Scouts. Yeah.
You know, come up on these explorers. We see a guy with the fedora, actually the same fedora, and looks like the same jacket. And I love how brilliant that scene is shot, because you think it's Indy. And then suddenly the camera pans up and he pulls his face up and you see it's not Indy.
It's the guy from Jurassic Park. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm kidding.
Jurassic Park.
And then the kid, the other kid talks to River Phoenix and he's like, Indy, Indiana. And you're like, oh, okay. And then we kind of get this whole like origin story. He's got this moral conviction that belongs
Sam Neill? You're talking about Sam Neill? Sam this Neill motherfucker.
Points that out. He's Indy.
This motherfucker. Why are you getting into Sam Neill? That's the wrong dude.
He wore
a fedora, but not he unlike Indiana Jones. Yeah,
like, come on, dude.
You know what I mean? Shit.
I'm like, he'd be a fake indie for a second, like Sam Neill. You know what I mean?
A little bit.
And then you're like, dude, nah, that's Harrison Ford's job.
Well, I mean, that is a Steven Spielberg movie, so yeah, there's going to be a little bit of an Indiana Jones.
You know what I'm saying, though, dude?
Undercurrent. That's why we both broke Jurassic out laughing, Park, dude. So yeah.
Oh my god. Yeah.
Oh shit.
But yeah, we get this whole sort of origin story for Indy. We see his moral conviction from a young age that belongs in a museum, but we also get like the origin of the fedora, the bullwhip, the chin scar that is actually an actual real chin scar that Harrison Ford has in real life.
Yeah.
The fear of snakes, whatever phobia that's called.
The fear of snakes is, it's kind of interesting because, first he's shown as not having any fear of snakes at all. He even throws a snake aside. But, I guess it was just, finally coming across a snake that he couldn't control, or snakes he couldn't control, freaked him out enough.
It's intentional, something. Yeah, because they show that young Indy's like, he literally says it's just a snake. It's kind of a...
Yeah.
The scene is actually humorous because of the way he reacts to the snake, right? It's kind of like, oh, he's not afraid of it. Like, okay, he's just a snake. But then he lands in a pit of snakes and it's like, and then from then on, it was just never the same. We saw this like complete shift.
Yeah, it was
motherfucking snakes on these motherfucking planes.
No, hell no. All these snakes on this motherfucking plane.
Hell no.
Fuck that.
No, let's open some motherfucking windows.
Open season all snakes.
These monkey fighting snakes off this Monday to Friday plane.
Friday to plane. I ain't got time for this.
Open some freaking windows.
This is rated for television, goddammit.
Exactly.
But yeah, and we even get, a little glimpse of Indy and his relationship with his father. And then, Robert, like you mentioned, that perfect just like cut where we get the young Indy to the old Indy.
Like tip the hat.
And then we get that second intro to the movie where we have now Indy's proper introduction,
Right.
And he's trying to once again get the Cross of Coronado back from this this villain that he's been hounding for all these years.
Right. And we kind of see like the fulfillment of that. And here's where the film actually really starts to parallel Raiders of the Lost Ark in a lot of ways. You start out with this like opening adventure where he comes back. We see him teaching class. He talks to Marcus Brody. They're going to go after this Judeo-Christian religious artifact that the Nazis are also after, and then they have to get it before the Nazis.
Before Captain America reached the Tesseract, I'm sorry.
Some dude reaches out to them. Some dude that's unknown or group of organization comes to Indy, requests him to go. He talks about it with Marcus Brody, decides to go, meets up with a father figure, and gets a chick along the way.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, no, that's pretty much Raiders to a T. I mean,
it's almost the same movie, and yet, you know, it works. Like, this movie is so good, actually, in my opinion, better than Raiders. It's my favorite Indiana Jones film. It manages, you know, and it's funny because of the backlash from Temple of Doom for being so different. Last Crusade decided to just do the exact same thing and arguably do it better. And it works. Nobody complained about it. It was like, because even though we're taking the same skeleton, we're building it with a different structure. And again, I think the chief thing that this brings to the table is Sean Connery. Because it's not the lady interest. Fuck that Nazi bitch.
Oh, absolutely. I don't like any of those Nazis either.
Those fucking bastards. She's a Nazi.
Fucking Nazi.
She's
cunt.
One of them. She's one of them.
You shot wow. him?
Sure.
Wow.
I've been nudged by the Queen, sure.
Yeah, quite a Queen, sure.
Yeah, so, you know, at first I was like, you know, I'm not sure if Willy the Diva or Elsa the Nazi are worse, but no, not Elsa's worse. She got what was coming to her.
They always get what's coming to them, isn't that right, Sean?
Yes, Sean.
That's right, Sean.
Yes, Sean.
Also, she fucked both Indy and his father. She fucked a father and the son. Like, that's just fucked up, man.
It is, I guess. I don't know.
It's not even about slut shaming, man. I don't care about that, okay?
It's like,
as
she's
somebody
a Nazi.
With personal experience in this matter.
She was a Nazi, and you just don't fuck Nazis, you know? You just don't.
That's true.
She wolf of the SS will break your heart.
Absolutely. Ilsa, she wolf of the SS.
So you need to know what you're getting yourself into.
Oh, yeah. You know, well, man, rest in peace, Diane Thorne.
Don't fall in love.
I have that movie, by the way.
I like it. It's on Tubi.
Again, Temple of Doom and Last Crusade actually kind of do this thing where the relationship with the girl in the movie isn't important. The girl isn't even important. She never comes up again. In this case, she dies, and she's kind of part of the villains.
Hell,
you know?
Hell, there's even that sequence where they go to Berlin. They have to go to Berlin to get the Grail book back from her.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, Indy actually shows a little bit of a proclivity towards possibly killing her, like, just because she's a fucking Nazi. And
all I have
like,
to do is squeeze.
Yeah. All I have to do is squeeze. It's like, sir, all she's like, all I have to do is scream. He's like, all I have to do is squeeze. Like, that's cold, man. But rightfully so, she's a Nazi. Fuck her.
Fuck her.
Reynolds. Oh.
Oh, and then he comes face to face with Hitler.
Oh, that's actually an interesting scene. It's like, here he is. He's in disguise. He is brought to this book burning, which, if you know anything about the book burnings, is like the first. The first book burnings was pretty much all of the literature on trans and other LGBTQ people. You know, that was the first book burning. So that's pretty much what's being burned there.
And he comes face to face with Hitler.
Yeah,
with the Grail diary that his dad mailed to him, which the Nazis stole, which then he had to get back.
The very thing that Hitler wants, it's right there in front of him. And what does he do? Just out of pure cynicism, just opens it up and signs it and gives it to Indy.
Yeah,
I would say it's like practically cynical in a way.
The contempt on Harrison Ford's face too. Like, he does a really good job of just showing like Indiana's contempt,
absolute contempt for Nazis, which is what you should absolutely have.
But also bewilderment.
Have.
Like, holy shit, this is fucking Hitler.
Absolutely, it's like no motherfucking literal Hitler right in front of you.
But it's a scene that works with no dialogue.
No dialogue at all. No, they just look at each other, and then the like homeboy that played Hitler just looks down at him, looks at the book, signs it, and sends him on his way. It's like, once again, you know, I forget who said it, you know, it's like that was an example of the banality of evil, sort of, you know?
Yeah. But yeah, there's just so many of these just like comedic moments. Like I, again, the movie is just consistently funny. Like that exchange with Hitler, and then right after it, maybe my favorite, like my most the funniest scene out of the entire trilogy for me, is the scene where Indy and Henry are on board the blimp. They're flying out of Berlin. Nazis come on board. So Indy actually, takes notice of this. Starts talking to one of the flight attendants. I love how brilliantly this is written, by the way. He's just talking to this flight attendant, his arm around his shoulder. They come around the corner. Indy comes around the corner in the flight attendant's clothes. You know exactly what happened without ever having to see it. You know, he comes around, and while the Nazis are looking for both of the Joneses on board, Indiana is you know, pretending that he's like asking for tickets, please. And, you know, and then the main Nazi guy in the movie, I forget his name, he finds Henry Sr. and Indy comes from behind him, tickets, please. Punches that fucking Nazi, throws him out the window. As the passengers look at him bewildered, he simply states, "No ticket."
Yeah, obviously, bro. They were looking for the Rocketeer. You know.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
All right.
Yeah, that could actually be a good little double feature with Last Crusade is the Rocketeer.
The Rocketeer. Honestly. Watch that Disney Plus.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
If you hadn't seen it, I think they're talking about redoing that movie.
I would love for there to be a new Rocketeer, dude. That would be fucking amazing.
I'm like, dude, I don't know if you should redo that movie. That movie is badass.
Not redo it, but I'd do a proper sequel.
Even for a Disney movie back then, dude, that movie was badass, you know?
Yeah, but I mean, talk about another movie that benefited from Indiana Jones a little bit in feel. The Rocketeer is actually kind of like that a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that kind of has that Indiana Jones, you know, international intrigue.
Exactly. International vibe to it. Has to deal with Howard Hughes.
Really. Yeah, it does.
His flight pattern.
Recall.
Honestly, in the whole Rocketeer thing, Howard Hughes made
it. And it also had the Nazis as antagonists.
Howard Hughes made the entire rocket pack for the Rocketeer.
Yeah, but remember, the Nazis were trying to steal that.
Yeah, were trying to get a hold of that.
So maybe the Rocketeer may have been a better, you know, indirect Indiana Jones sequel than anything. And then
that one mechanic turned it around with the helmet just alone, making a rudder to the helmet. And then just, I don't know what else he did to the rocket, though.
He put a wad of gum on a leak.
Yeah, that was a bullet hole, right?
He put a lot of...
Yeah, that was a bullet hole he tried to slip.
That is actually another example of a movie that actually benefited from Indiana Jones, and also especially from Last Crusade, I kind of feel, you know, because, you know, Last Crusade, it actually brought a little more of the international intrigue.
The Rocketeer brings in the aviation era, like from the Wright brothers.
Yeah.
All of it, dude. So,
and it still has Indiana Jones just kind of written all over it.
It really does. Know? It does. I mean,
but yeah,
from what the hero did, it has like that old school theater play, that chapter play.
And going back to the blimp scene in Indiana Jones, interesting little callback in Dogma, if y'all still have this movie, which is kind of really difficult to find nowadays because of one Harvey motherfucking rotten balls Weinstein.
Yeah.
But I digress. But yeah, in that movie, there's the scene where Loki and Bartleby make friends with Linda Fiorentino's character and everything, and Jay and Silent Bob is there, and they're actually chilling and whatnot. And then once the Prophet recognizes them, Silent Bob eventually kicks them out of the moving train. And then he looks at a customer, at another passenger that's looking at him. And he just shrugs and says, "No ticket."
This is after he takes a long drag off a cigarette.
Absolutely.
And then he looks at them, and just the way he delivers the line is just like, it's a reference done right.
Absolutely. And I mean, all the mannerisms are there and everything, and it actually makes sense. You know, he threw them out of a moving train this time instead of a blimp. And it's like, it's a great little callback.
Yeah. And I don't know, it's almost like the way that Kevin Smith delivers the line, it's like, it's like Silent Bob has actually been like waiting to like make that reference.
And see, that's his one is one line per movie.
That's you his know, one line in that one. Yeah.
This is one line in that movie right there is no ticket.
So it's like both Kevin Smith and Silent Bob were waiting to make that reference. Because again, that scene is just so fucking iconic. It's so simple when you think about it, but it's so effective. There's another gag that's like that in this movie, that where, you know, they're in the library and he's banging the tile on the floor in order to gain access to the catacombs.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's the old man who's stamping, and every time he stamps down, Indy hits the tile, and the dude just...
and yeah, the librarian is just like, what
the librarian,
fuck?
Yeah.
Yeah, the librarian's like, well, hold on, and then he hits the ink, then it's like, whoa, and then he just keeps on doing the boom, it's like, he's like, oh, yeah, and he just kind of gets into it, right? That's hilarious. That's perfect use of a background character for humor.
It really is. I mean, and like that whole scene is just even that one scene is littered with just little moments like that. There's the X marks the spot moment, which earlier in the film, Indy is telling that to his students that X never ever marks the spot. And then, you know, when the Roman numeral 10 is on the floor, and
it's an obvious X marks the spot.
And you know what? That line wouldn't normally work, but one, because it was built up earlier in the film, and two, because of Harrison Ford's delivery of the line, it actually does work, and there's no, like, cringe at all.
He's actually kind of exasperated. He's like, X marks the spot. X
marks the spot.
He's like, you got to be kidding me, kind of, you know? Yeah. He has that vibe to him. He's like, you got to be fucking kidding me here. Really?
Yeah. It's just like little like bits of humor at every angle.
You know what? I mean, he's a real Chad here because he actually manages to retain his skepticism, even though literally seeing evidence of both the Jewish Yahweh and the Hindu Kali having actually existed. You know?
And then there's that line in Temple of Doom where he's like, you betrayed Shiva. Like,
yeah, you betrayed Shiva. Like, actually acknowledging the Hindu gods exist and everything. It's like...
But he remains a skeptic throughout, you know...
He does. He still is like, I don't believe in that hocus pocus superstitious nonsense.
I'll tell you what, and I'll give it one prop, and we'll actually acknowledge its existence, but Dial of Destiny kind of addresses that.
Really?
It does. There's a scene where he kind of says something to acknowledging the fact that he's seen things that he couldn't explain, but he still maintains his skepticism.
And that's why, because he still can't explain what he experienced. He just knows he experienced it.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. Exactly. And actually, Indiana Jones is me. That would be me. I would go through these situations and still have a healthy bit of skepticism. Like, I don't necessarily believe in this just because I saw this. There's some kind of explanation for this.
Yeah, and that's why I feel like these movies are, you know, so important to this day, you know? Not only because of the themes of anti-fascism and anti-authoritarianism that's, I mean, permeated through this movie. But something we haven't really touched on is, you know, how utterly... you know, anti-authoritarian this series is.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, it's also about skepticism, you know? It's one of the underlying themes of this movie, and that's why it's important in this day and age of misinformation and disinformation coming from, you know, certain sources, you know, and everything. But it's like... we need somebody to be, be like the Neil deGrasse Tyson of just pure skepticism. We used to have, you know, like Carl Sagan. We used to have, what was his name? The magician that always tried to debunk supernatural shit. I forget his name.
I know who you're talking about, but I can't think of it either.
Yeah. God damn it. We will find out about it and put it in our show notes. Like, they'll just be like, by the way, this was like, oh my God, his name is on the tip of my tongue, but I'm just too stoned to fucking think of
it. I can't go to sleep, but I'll remember right when I wake up, if I ever do wake up.
Yeah.
that type of thing.
But yeah, it's like we need voices of skepticism and of critical thinking in this 100%. Day and age. And I think that that's what Indiana Jones kind of symbolized to me more than anything.
Really?
Is this really always keeping a rational and skeptical and critical eye on everything, but you know, still also accepting that there are things in this world that you can't fucking explain. You know, that science may not even be able to explain.
Honestly.
Or who knows, maybe there are easy explanations. We just haven't come across them yet. I should have been,
dude, bros, I should have been watching this series back to back with E.T. back in the day.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that's another great Spielberg movie right there. You know,
that's the thing. I never saw the indie series when I was a kid.
I'm sad for that, dude. You would have resonated with this shit as a kid.
Moments of this movie are burned into my memory. Absolutely. Like the final sequence with the Grail challenges.
Yeah.
Like, I saw the first Jurassic Park. I saw E.T. I never saw Indiana Jones, and it was before any of that, though. You know what I mean?
Damn. That's kind of sad, man. I feel for you there a little bit because... This series was so integral to my childhood next to, like, Ghostbusters.
It makes me feel like I missed on a whole big adventure, really.
I know, man, and it sucks to kind of feel that way.
Well, and it's like you even grew up on some of the films that were inspired by this, too.
Yeah, see, like what I was telling you guys, the Goonies is like, dude, that inspired the whole adventure for me, actually.
It's like in the Goonies is in and of itself kind of an Indiana Jones.
Before, because of the same actor, and Spielberg being the director, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's almost the same adventure. They're leading you to the same adventure, and it's just like...
Yeah.
The adventure continues, right, dude?
Absolutely, you're not wrong, dude.
You want the adventure to continue, really.
Yeah.
Never over.
It's never truly really, over.
It's never ogre.
With the Spielberg journey, it's never over. Yeah.
And in many ways, this was Spielberg at his pre-Schmaltz era. You know, I mean, he really touched on that with maybe, you know, to a degree, E.T. and maybe somewhat Close Encounters. But this was where he dropped the Schmaltz, and he was just like, "No, we're going to put forth a very straightforward kind of action adventure series with sometimes dark and violent overtones."
Yeah. No, like you know, and just even some like the sequences. But yeah, going back to that final sequence, you know, where they're facing the challenges of the Grail, like, man, like I can just I just remember these scenes so vividly. Like I could almost quote them even like however many fucking years it is later now, man, 15 plus.
You know, the penitent man kneels in order to go through the breath of God. And then the
20 years.
Yeah. The name of God, you know, Jehovah.
Yeah. Yeah. And so the penitent man, the breath of God, the name of God, and then the path of God, just like these little like just booby trap sequences and like the whole illusion with the path of God. And it's so good, man.
In so many ways, that's like the most memorable part of the movie is when they actually,
penitent man, the penitent man,
penitent man. Exactly.
Jehovah starts with an I.
Yeah, and when we get to that sequence, and then you have like the stakes involved with Henry being shot and everything, you know,
the stakes are higher, because Indy has to find the Grail now in order to save his father, who's going to die, and these characters have built up this relationship, this bond over the film. Over the past 20 years, they hadn't spoken much, but over the course of this adventure, they both go through character arcs. Indiana learning to deal with the way that his father, treated him growing up, you know, the way he taught him to depend on himself, like he eloquently puts. And Henry, you know, kind of coming to terms with what needs to be done. At the beginning of the film, you know, he's like, when Indy, you know, takes the gun, shoots a bunch of Nodsmees, I said, don't call me Junior. He's like, what have you done? You know, look what you've done. But at the end of the movie, he's fucking shooting Nazis from tanks too.
Absolutely. And even employing
seagulls,
you know, employing innovative tactics to take the Nazis down, you know,
like, with Brad seagulls. Pitt and Fury, dude.
Oh. Yeah, he did the same thing, right?
He did the same thing.
Yeah.
Inglorious Bastards too.
Yeah, exactly.
So that was probably a reference.
Honestly, you got to see the same sergeant from going Inglourious Basterds to Fury, Brad Pitt.
I'm sure that both of those movies use this movie as an influence for
The Fury,
which is awesome.
The Fury, I want to show you, bros, the Fury movie.
Oh yeah, Fury is a great war movie.
That came out like 10 years ago. I think we missed out on that, dude.
We did. We should have talked about it by now.
We should have.
On the podcast.
And as a war movie, dude, it stands alone as a great war movie, dude.
Oh, no, I got a way better war movie than that.
And I have my war movies. I have a lot of war movies that are fucking near and dear to me, too. Yeah. They're mostly spiritual. And, yeah. But you got Hacksaw Ridge, Platoon, dude. That's...
Well, and Indiana Jones, I think, works so well because it references World War II. I mean, it's not technically a war movie, but it's set during a war mostly, except for Temple of Doom.
But
using that as the backdrop is able to immediately connect with your audience.
Yeah, what I love with war movies is kind of like the brother camaraderie.
Yeah.
When the actors come out of like within the story.
True, yeah.
Mostly kind of like Forrest Gump is Vietnam too, but most people don't even like Forrest Gump, but it's a true story too.
Yeah, but it's kind of like, like the experiences that you come to through together.
Exactly.
When you're facing death, and that's something not dissimilar to what Indy and Henry go through.
Exactly. I mean, they're
and ultimately culminates in
Platoon. I love that movie, dude.
Platoon.
Like, we got to go back and watch that movie too. It's got a Willem Dafoe. He's a their sergeant too. You're gonna like it, dude. I don't know if you actually seen it, but it's got Charlie Sheen.
Here's an impactful war movie.
1986 right film, bro.
Here's an impactful war movie. Grave of the Fireflies.
Nice.
Yeah. This movie's
Vietnam films will
and come and see. Come and see is really brutal.
Vietnam films will fuck with you actually a little bit. Just kind of like the way they were made. And World War II films, not bad at all either. The Fury movies, kind of like a brother line, invading the Nazis in World War II. But we need to watch that.
Absolutely. Hell yeah.
Brad Pitt, it's haircut. I was almost going to cut my hair like that.
I'm sure you were, Robert.
I was.
Yeah, you drive, right?
I do drive.
You drive?
Like a speed demon.
Very fast. Drive.
Very fast.
Or the leader of that government does. He's like Rolls Royce.
Yeah, no shit.
What government was that? Like, what country was that? I don't even remember, man. And I watched this movie like 3 times over at least in like the last like 2 weeks. But like the dude that gets all like.
Oh yeah, that's in Temple of Doom, right?
No, that's in Last Crusade.
Crusade. Yeah, you're right. It's in Last Crusade.
Because they're asking to excavate the Grail, which is really interesting that he's willing to like sacrifice this like object that supposedly grants immortality, for like a Rolls Royce or whatever. But maybe he just doesn't believe in it. I don't know.
Maybe so. I mean, in the end, it is a Christian artifact, and he's clearly not Christian.
Muslim.
It's Monty Python's Holy Grail. I'm sorry.
Monty Python's Holy Grail, which we talked about already.
Which we already did.
We've already done that movie.
So
before.
Go back and visit that episode if you can.
Absolutely. Yeah. Maybe we should push Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
That was a good episode. I like that episode.
That was a great episode.
I feel like we're like, I don't know. I feel younger just revisiting these episodes.
Dude. I know. It's been a while. I mean?
It's been a while, dude.
Yeah. We're going on our 7th anniversary here pretty soon. So yeah.
We are getting old.
We are.
It's
But anyway, Last Crusade.
Oh, God, man.
Last Crusade probably, to me, here's my thing about these three movies. It's like, I mean, Raiders has the best story and the best intro. Temple of Doom is the best standalone movie, because of its prequel and everything. And it to me, it has the most cinematic intro. This movie right here, it's arguably the ending is better. The ending sequence in the Temple of the Holy Grail and everything. It's like that is
he
actually
chose poorly.
It goes poorly. Yeah, he chose poorly. It's like that's like the best ending out of all of the movies, So that's how I kind of approach these movies. And I mean, It's like they all have are like greater parts of an equal sum, you know. It's like, and there's parts of these movies that, you know, even if you just kind of take them out of context and they stand alone and everything, they're still really, really memorable and iconic moments.
100%.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, these films are full of iconic moments. Like, I mean, you know, again, going back to the banter between Henry and Indy, like, you know, some of these moments, I just remember vividly, like line for line, you know, "Dad, what? Dad, what?" "Head for the fireplace." And then the comedic timing with that scene where, like, you know, they hop around the moving fire, the rotating fireplace a couple times, and there's that one moment. This is where the timing is just perfect. You know, they look at the Nazi lady, they smile sheepishly, she smiles back. "Alarm!"
Exactly. "Alarm!" Yeah. They find the Nazi bunker and everything.
Yeah.
Like, oh shit, man, that's funny. Goddamn Nazis.
"I have something to tell you. Dad, don't get sentimental on me now. The floor's on fire."
So, my sword.
My sword. That's right. I'm going to do the rest of this review, like, doing Sean Connery voice.
And then we got to talk about the final scene of the movie.
Oh, yes.
The reveal, of course, that Indiana Jones is not his real name. I don't, maybe, you know, in the novelizations or promotional material, it may have already been known that he was Henry Jones Jr. I don't know. But for most film watchers, they think this was where we learned that his name wasn't really Indiana Jones. And they kind of poke fun at it in Temple of Dune with that one scene where he's like, my professional name, you know, and she's like, Indiana. You know, but like here, you know,
we named the dog Indiana.
We named the dog Indiana.
You are named after Indiana. The dog? I have a lot of fun memories.
Oh, we
of
haven't
that
brought
dog.
Up Sala in this movie, dude. Sala
the
is
Return
great.
Of Sala.
Yeah, dude. Man, John Rhys Davies.
I fucking love him,
man. He's perfect in this movie, and it's a perfect compliment to his work in Raiders. You know, perfect.
It is, and I'm glad that they brought him back. So that's another element of Raiders.
Really? And also Brody.
And Brody, who plays a much more major role this time.
Absolutely.
He actually, you know, it's funny, in Raiders, I think he says, "I'm much too old for this." And then in Last Crusade, which chronologically
takes
place later.
Oh, no, this one, he's just like, "No, let's go."
It's the Grail, he asked you, right?
Yeah, he's like, "No." And yeah, he asked you, he's like, "No, screw this, I'm going."
The search for the Grail is the search for the divine in all of us.
Absolutely. I guess so.
Such an impactful line.
It really is. And it, yeah, that's the that's his justification for tailing with him, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like, and he's a fun character as well, you know?
Oh, I love Brody. You know, it was that moment where Indy bluffs and he's like, you know, he speaks a dozen languages. He can blend into any environment. At any rate, he's got a two-head start. With any luck, he's got the Grail already. "Does anyone here speak English? Excuse me." And then right after with Sala, and he's like, "Run." "What?" "Suddenly, you know, blah, blah, blah. Run.
Run. Fucking run." "Run."
"You mean, yes, run.
Run.
Yes, run. Go.
Run, Indiana."
And then he ends up in Nazi custody anyways. God damn it, Brody. God damn it. Oh my god.
Got lost in his own museum.
He got lost in his own museum. What?
Chris Hemsworth.
Got lost in his own museum, huh? Got lost in his own museum, huh?
We're about to complete a great quest. The Holy Grail, Dr. Jones.
Oh, rats.
This is it. Look, the shield is the second marker. We found it.
Indiana Jones is on the quest of a lifetime. But for some adventures, one Jones is not enough.
Dad? Junior?
Don't call me that, please.
Follow me! Out of the way!
Race across three continents.
And in this sort of race, there's no silver medal for finishing second.
Hang on, Dad, we're going in!
Into the homeland of the enemy.
Nazis. I hate these guys. situation has not improved.
In his search for the Holy Grail.
How dare you kiss me?
Are you crazy? Don't go between them!
Go between them, are you crazy?
Where's my father?
In the belly of that steel beast.
Dad! Junior!
You call this archaeology?
The quest for the Grail is not archaeology. It's a race against evil.
Germany has declared war on the Jones boys.
Those people are trying to kill us.
I know, Dad!
It's a new experience for me.
Happens to me all the time. Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. Have the adventure of your life. Keeping up with the Joneses.
So many just iconic characters. I know we've probably said that word like a dozen fucking times across both of these episodes, but this is the epitome of iconic, like all three of these movies. I mean, I guess we can sort of get into our final thoughts on Last Crusade and the Indiana Jones trilogy as a whole here. Bo?
Yeah, man, this is just one of those franchises that I can always go back to, and I can always expect, you know, everything that I experienced before, you know what I mean? It's like, I can't feel that for Star Wars. I can kind of feel that for Ghostbusters. That's one of those franchises for me, but Indiana Jones is definitely one of those franchises for me. You know?
I can't really say that because, you know, I haven't really seen it enough.
Yeah.
What do you think about these movies having watched them now, Robert?
Having watched them now, I just want to put them all over again. Like, I want to watch Raiders of the Lost Ark again.
They're so rewatchable, right?
They are rewatchable. I think they withstand the time era, the test of time.
Yeah, it stands the test of time. Yeah. And to this day, you can put them on, you can find things that are creepy about it. You can find things that are funny about it. Like, you can find things that are you know, dramatic about it.
I was telling you guys, like, I'm just a little mad at myself that I hadn't seen them before, you know?
I know, man, and it's like, that's, to me, it's unconscionable because Indiana Jones has been with me for so long. You know, it's just been a part of my life.
It's kind of like
childhood thing,
Yeah, it's kind of like part of the way that I view cinema.
Yeah.
And I think even for those of us that didn't grow up with this, I think it's influenced us indirectly, as I mentioned earlier. I mean, as for my final thoughts, I feel that, you know, these movies are just so infinitely rewatchable that, like, I not only watched the trilogy at least like two or three times over in preparation for this podcast and watched them all again a few months ago, but I Last Crusade, I think I watched at least three or four times, like, just alone. And I ended up showing it to a buddy of mine because, I mean, it's just like, it's so good. And if I had to show one of them, I know, I think last episode I said, if you have to watch one Indiana Jones movie, it's Raiders. He said he had seen Raiders already. So yeah. I showed him Last Crusade. And I mean, it's just like any of these movies are a good time. You can show them to just about anyone and have a good time. Again, like you said, Robert, they stand the test of time. They're brilliant, even in their simplicity.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and Harrison Ford is just really giving it his all. You've got an all-star team, including Steven Spielberg and George Lucas. And I know Lawrence Kasdan and Philip Kaufman wrote Raiders.
Yeah.
Let's see.
I think these movies will forever be frozen in time.
They will be. I mean, this is my Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. There,
you know?
See, Jeffrey Boehm wrote the screenplay for Last Crusade. Mino Mayhez also co-wrote the story. And then Temple of Doom. Screenplay by Willard Huick, Gloria Katz, and So yeah, that's everybody that helps direct and
write the
Indiana Jones movies. Of course, Steven Spielberg, you know, is just, you know, just a master of his craft, and Harrison Ford as well, just phenomenal. This is them at their peak, honestly.
Absolutely. And also, like we said earlier, Spielberg at his least schmaltziest, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe the relationship between Indy and his dad gets a little schmaltzy, but that's the closest this series gets to that.
Yeah, it's just, yeah. It's so good, man. But yeah, guys, this has been a relatively long episode, but we were covering two movies, so that's to be expected. Two classic movies that, you know, demand in-depth discussion.
I know it kind of feels like we barely scratched the surface, even, you know, in so right? many that ways too,
I'm just glad we got this much recorded, really. But
honestly, we just kind of went off on both of these movies, and that's
tangents and
even with tangents and everything, and we still covered, you know, so barely little about this movie, I feel, you know, and we still went in depth.
And we still didn't cover the Crystal Skull, so yeah, well,
that never happened.
I don't know what movie you're talking about, yeah. Robert. No, this is not happening on this podcast, Robert.
Yeah,
this is not happening. There was no Shia LaBeouf. Shia LaBeouf is a figment of your imagination.
But he's Robert. Even Steven.
Just so. Do it.
He's even Steven. I don't know what even Steven is even.
Even
do it. Stevens. Do it. What do you mean do it?
Make your dreams come true.
You can make fire with your mind. Yes, just do it.
Just do it.
Just
you can go
do it.
You can go Super Saiyan.
Just do it.
My name is Jay Lynn, and I am a Super Saiyan.
He's endorsing fire and Camaros. Okay.
Absolutely.
You just gotta do it.
Jesus Christ.
Fucking Camaros. Bitching Camaros.
Bitching Camaro like the dead milkman. Shit. Hell yeah.
Dude, I was telling Jesse, dude, just shove a Corvette engine behind a fucking old Camaro. Oh my God, right?
Fucking hey, dude.
Still the same GM motor. Fuck.
Jesus Christ, guys, what is this episode devolved into?
I don't know anymore, dude.
Wait, I feel like Sean Connery should slap me for that. And
that's
say,
right.
That's
I'm going to slap you. Slap. Slap, slap, slap. That's what I did to you.
Okay, and what are you going to say?
That's for blasphemy. That's for blasphemy.
This is Entrapment, Catherine Zeta-Jones.
If you enjoyed this episode, let us know. Leave feedback on your platform of choice. We'll go ahead and we'll link all of our podcast platforms and social medias in the show notes. So go check us out there. We also do have a Patreon where you can get access to exclusive full-length movie commentaries. Also, you can buy us a coffee.
Absolutely. And also check us out on Spreadshirt.com under Collateral Media Podcasts. You can find shirts, hats, mugs, tote bags, and stickers, and all kinds of collateral cinema and collateral media swag. So check us out there. And also look us up on Good Pods. Listen to us there and vote for us, like us and follow us and help us kind of climb the ranks of the
corporate ladder.
Not so much the corporate ladder, but the weekly indie movie.
I was going to say the indie charts. Corporate ladder. I'm sorry.
No, it's the charts, bro.
The indie charts. Ladder?
The indie charts.
The indie charts.
And many thanks to people in Uganda and Sri Lanka and also, I mean, every now and again, Japan for listening to us. You know, that's really, really cool.
I'm just...
Domo arigato.
Honestly, I'm just thankful that we have an audience that likes us.
Yeah, no, yeah. Seriously. We're actually kind of having some listener retention even. Yeah. So, hell yeah.
I'm thankful for an audience.
We are very thankful for every single download, every single listen, every single like, every single five-star review that you can leave on Apple Podcasts and on Good Pods.
Even if we think we're just fucking idiots too or whatever. Yeah.
And also, on our YouTube, check out Texas Sundown, our new short film directed by this man right here.
I didn't do it.
Written and directed by Robert Ortegon.
I didn't do it.
And also starring Robert Ortegon and Ashley Chancellor and my Bo Maddox and Jesse Ortegon.
My brother is in there too. Yeah.
Yeah. And shot by Jesse and Bo and all of us.
And John Cena is actually in the film as well. You just can't see him.
No, you can't see him. He's somewhere in there, but you just, I dare you to see him.
I think he disappeared.
I dare you to find him.
And then he reappeared and then CM Punk.
He reappeared. He's somewhere in the bushes, I guess.
And then CM Punk hit him with a finisher and then.
Oh, but CM Punk is gone.
And then he was out of the Royal Rumble.
He's out of the Royal Rumble, out of WrestleMania. Out of WrestleMania.
And then,
because it's because he wanted to act uppity.
And now Cody Rhodes is telling the story.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. God damn it. And also fuck Vince McMahon, by the way. Fuck Vince McMahon. He's a terrible, horrible, horrible person. Just terrible person. Right, Robert?
Look for Texas Sundown 2. Look for Texas Sundown 2.
Yes.
We may be working two other shorts in between that, but I somewhat have an idea for that.
Texas awesome. Sundown 2, yeah. Until Sunrise.
Until Sunrise.
Until Dawn.
Sundown Harder.
You see, I'm still shuffling with the title, Ash.
Texas Sundown 2.
Texas Sundown 2, Electric Boogaloo.
Texas Sundown 2, obvious. Texas Blood Money, or From Dusk Till Dawn, Till Sunrise, or something.
Those are all too obvious, though, Robert.
It's too obvious.
Let's think of something more
really
original.
That's what I was telling you. I think we need to go back to the beginning here.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Texas Sun Up.
Texas Sun.
There you go. Hey, that is a good fucking title.
There you go. There you go.
Or I guess it would actually be Sunrise.
Texas Sunrise.
Texas.
Wait a second.
Tequila Sunrise. Well, we have Tequila Sunrises, and then we do sundowns.
Texas Sunrise.
And then we do a Tequila Sundown after a sunrise.
Tequila Sundown. Is that just going to be our Andy Sedaris movie?
Oh no, that's just dude. I think we're just fucking jokers. It's funny as shit.
Ooh. So, what's coming up next on Collateral Cinema? What are we doing next?
Coming up next, we should be talking about The Wraith.
Starring Charlie Sheen.
I believe we have a guest host on that. I don't remember who it is. I don't have my phone close to me.
That is a good Charlie Sheen movie, and it's a car movie that I chose.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, the Wraith, we're going to have guest hosts on that. We'll have an announcement for that here very soon. Yeah, check out the episode I did with the Vern from Cinema Recall and Kaylee from Once Over with Kaylee. It's on Dogtooth, a very interesting movie. So, yeah, check me out there, and also listen to them on... Once Over with Kaylee on YouTube and Cinema Recall on your favorite podcast app.
Dope. Alrighty. So yeah, check that out. I believe you're also doing something with Project Echo with Retro Anime Podcast, right?
Yes. I will be talking about the first Project Echo movie, all about lesbian schoolgirls who can fight and are very... And there's like a planet of they're all women, but some of them are masculine. And then they there's fighting, and Biko wants Seiko or something. I don't know. It's a crazy anime, people. Just watch it on Tubi. It's on Tubi, Project Echo. And yes, we will be or at least I will be joined by the anime, the Retro Anime Podcast, to talk about that movie. So yeah. Check us out on that episode coming very soon. And of course, our Mikaversary will also be focusing on the happiness of the Katakuri. So look for that as well.
Fuck yeah. Well, all right, guys. I guess that'll just about do it. With all that being said, I've been Ashley Chancellor.
I am Sean Connery.
I'm Robert Ortegon.
And this has been Collateral Gaming. We are...
Oh, my God.
Jesus Christ.
Okay. And this has been Collateral Cinema.
And this has been absolutely intolerable.
This is entrapment.
This has been completely intolerable.
It's intolerable, 100%. Shaken, not stirred, my new
That's pie. Right, Junior. Indiana.
Junior.
Indiana, let it go.
Let it go, Indiana.
Laters.
Collateral Cinema is a collateral media podcast. All music and movie clips are owned by the respective creators and are used for educational purposes only. Please don't sue us. We're poor.